Last time we looked at what happens when the integral of f of x dx diverges. This time we're going to look at what happens when the integral from 1 to infinity of f of x dx converges. So in particular, I'm going to look at the function f of x is equal to 1 over x squared, which I've graphed here. And we want to figure out what happens to the sum of 1 over n squared. Well, instead of using the boxes above, we're going to use the boxes below. So we're going to use this box, and the height of this box is 1 over 2 squared times the width of this box, which is 1. So we get that f of 2 is less than or equal to the integral from 1 to 2 of f of x dx. And then for the next box, we're going to start off with f of 3. We're going to use right endpoints. So f of 3 is less than or equal to the integral from 2 to 3 of f of x dx. And we keep adding boxes, more and more and more boxes. And we get the sum of all of the terms, except f of 1. We've left out f of 1. But we get that the sum of all of the terms is less than the area under the curve. But the area under the curve is bounded. So the sum of all the terms also has to be bounded. And that means that our sum has got to converge. So more formally, we have f of 2 is less than equal to an integral, f of 3 is less than or equal to an integral, down to f of n is less than or equal to an integral. If you add up the left-hand side, you get Sn minus f of 1. We don't have an f of 1 here. We just have f of 2 through f of n. And on the right-hand side, we've got the integral from 1 to n of f of x dx. Add f of 1 to both sides, and you've got that the nth partial sum is bounded by f of 1 plus this integral. And now let's take it a limit as n goes to infinity. As n goes to infinity, this approaches sum number L. So all of the partial sums are bounded by f of 1 plus L. And that means that the Sn's form a bounded sequence. It's a monotonic sequence because each Sn is bigger or equal to the previous one. So since it's a bounded monotonic sequence, it's got to converge. Now, we can say some things about what it converges to. See, we just saw that the sum of the first n terms was bounded by f of 1 plus the integral from 1 to n of f of x dx. We also saw that it was at most the integral from 1 to n plus 1 of f of x dx because of that's what we would get if we used the left endpoints and used those boxes. So that means that Sn is somewhere in between these two guys. Now we take a limit as n goes to infinity, and we get that the sum from n goes to 1, from 1 to infinity is at least as big as the integral, and it's at most the integral plus the first term. So that gives us a pretty good sense of how these infinite sums are behaving. They're behaving just like the integrals. What's more is we could use the same argument instead of starting at the first step, starting at the nth step. Now here I'll have to call it the sum of f of I instead of f of n because we're starting at n. And then you want it with the integral from n to infinity, and you get the same notion. And this actually gives us a very good way to estimate the size of an infinite sum. Because if we take all the terms starting with the nth term, and then add on the first n minus 1 terms, you get the sum of all of the terms. So if you add the first n minus 1 terms over here, you get Sn minus 1 plus this. If you add the first n minus 1 terms over here, well, you add that to the nth term and you get Sn. So we've got that the total the total sum is somewhere in between the first n minus 1 terms plus this integral and the first n terms plus this integral. So for example, if you wanted to figure out what was the sum of 1 over n squared from 1 to infinity, you could add up the first 10 terms, 1 plus a quarter plus a ninth plus a 16th up to 1/100th, and then add on the integral from 10 to infinity of 1 over x squared dx. And that's a pretty easy integral. It gives you a tenth. And so we know that the sum as n goes from 1 to infinity of 1 over n squared is roughly this. Now, actually, I used this expression. So the actual sum is slightly less than this. If we had done the integral from 11 to infinity, that would have been a 1/11th. We would have gotten something that's a little bit more than the actual value. So this doesn't give you the exact value, but it gives you very close. And in fact, this would give you the value to two decimal places.